Om Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam Mauna Vyakhya Prakatita Parabrahma Tattvam Yuvanam Varshishtante Vasadrishiganairavritam Brahmanishthaihi Acharyendram Karakalita Chinmudramananda Rupam Swatma Ramam Mudita Vadanam Dakshinamurthy Mide Vatavitapi Samipe Bhumi Bhage Nishannam Sakala Muni Jananam Jnana Tataram Arat Tribhuvana Guru Misham Dakshinamurthy Devam Janana Marana Dukkha Cheda Dakshanamami Chitram Vatatarur Mule Vriddha Shishya Guru Yuva Gurostu Maunam Vyakhyanam Shishyastu Chinna Samshayaha Nidhaye Sarva Vidyanam Bhishaje Bhavaroginam Gurave Sarva Lokanam Dakshinamurthaye Namaha Om Namah Pranavarthaya Shuddha Jnanaika Murtaye Nirmalaya Prashantaya Dakshinamurthaye Namaha Ishvaro Guru Ratmeti Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyomavad Vyapta Dehaya Dakshinamurthaye Namaha Balyadishvapi Jagradadishutatha Sarvasvavasthaswapi Vyavritta Svanuvartamanamahamityantas Purantam Sada Swatmanam Prakati Karoti Bhajatam Yomudraya Bhadraya Tasmai Shri Guru Murtaye Namaidam Shri Dakshinamurthaye. So we were looking at the seventh verse, and Sureshvara was explaining about the error, Brahma. The different error, how they do not fit in really. He pointed out the inconsistencies and the illogical nature of these different theories put forward by different darshanikas, those who have their own views. So this theory of error is traditionally called Khyativada. So different Khyativada were negated, and finally the Anirvachaniya Khyati means you cannot categorize whatever appears. The appearance of snake on a rope cannot be categorized either as true, you cannot categorize it as totally false. So it is essentially uncategorizable, and it does not also lend itself to any logical explanation. That is why it is Maya or Anirvachaniya. It is like magic only. Okay. If you can explain it logically, it is no more magic. Even in magic shows also, it's the same thing, correct? Only something is a magic till we don't know how it happens. If we know what the magician actually did for us to see whatever we saw, then it does not anymore, it is not considered to be a magic, correct? It's not magical. So that's what here, this whatever we are seeing in an erroneous cognition, that erroneous cognition cannot be actually explained logically. Okay. And if you can explain it logically, then you cannot even say it is a bhranti or erroneous cognition. That's what this verse 27, Sureshvara points out. What is the anirvachaniya khyati? So it's actually essentially uncategorizable as this or that. You cannot categorize it properly. And that is what is the view. Okay. Then he went on to give different analogies, because there can be doubts or even objections that how can one Atma appear as all these many sentient beings. So for that, the one of the first analogies is what? Jala Chandravat Ekasmin Nirbhaye Raju Sarpavate. Like this he gives many examples are there. First example is Jala Chandravat Ekasmin. There is only one real Chandra, but it is appearing in many reflecting medium, like many water bodies as many moons, let us say. Similarly, this Atma, even though it is one, it is appearing as many sentient beings because there are many Sukshma Sharira, the subtle body, the Sukshma Sharira, there are many, the Upadhi is many, like even many reflecting media are there in the form of water bodies. But actually there is only one moon. That is one example. Then how, if Atma is Ananda Swarupa and it is the only one, how can it be a cause of fear then? How can fear be there? Okay, because Atma is called as Abhaya. Also, Abhaya Swarupa, Abhayam Pratishtam, Vindate, like that even Taittiriya Upanishad says. The one who knows Atma gains fearlessness or is established in fearlessness. So for that he is saying Rajju, the rope itself is actually Nirbhaye, means it is not, if you see the rope, you have no fear, correct? There is no fear in cognizing rope. But in that rope only, when we see the snake, that rope itself has now become a cause of fear. So even though the rope in itself does not or cannot be a cause of fear, but when you are perceiving snake on that, it can become a cause of fear. And also, another thing is what, another analogy is giving to point out that whatever you are seeing here, even though you are seeing many names and forms, what is really existing is only one. So Swarne Karane Katakadivat Yatha Pratiyate means you have only one gold, which is the cause of the entire gold universe. Although you may have many different names and forms like chains, bangles, bracelets, earrings, nose rings, whatever ornaments and jewels and jewelry you can name and you can count also. And each of them may have some function or some style or fashion, whatever it is. But all of them, what really exists there is only gold. If you go to a pawnbroker, the pawnbroker only sees gold. The weight of the chain is the weight of the gold. If you touch the chain, you are actually touching gold. The chain cannot exist without being gold, but the gold can exist even without being the chain. So although there are many names and forms which we are cognizing in this transactional world, all of them derive their very existence from Brahman alone, from one reality alone. So that is pointed out with the Swarna and Kataka as the analogy, the Karya Karana Prakriya essentially. All the Karya or Mithya, the Karana alone is Satyam. And there's only one Karana. Then what about if Atma is always experienced, correct? Atma is the only one we are experiencing all the time. Aparoksha Anubhava is there. Okay, whatever you are directly experiencing, how can you mistake it for something else? This also can be an argument. Okay, if you say that Atma is Swaprakasha, Svatasiddha and all that, how can there be any erroneous cognition with reference to Atma? Means there is no rule that whatever you can directly cognize or whatever you are directly cognizing on that, you won't make any error. For that they are showing this, whatever shell silver itself. The shell is direct pratyaksha right in front of your eyes, but still you can see silver on that. Okay. Then another analogy is given. What if Atma is all pervading, you are saying, only Atma alone is there, even space time is in Atma. How can an all pervading one be a locus of error? Means space is all pervading, but on space we still superimpose a color. Blue sky is actually an adhyasa. Or here, Gandharva Nagara or Yakshapuri, like that Sureshvara is saying. So there also you are actually having an erroneous cognition on the all-pervading space. So Yakshapuri eva kha means akasha. K is the seventh case of that. Then another objection. What is that? How can Atma, which is Prakasha Swarupa, be a locus of any avidya or ignorance, which is tamas? Okay. And be a locus of any kind of adhyasa, because something which is of the nature of Prakasha Swarupa, which itself is light, how can it be mistaken for something else? Means for that they are giving the analogy of Mrigatrishnika or Rashmi Ambu. Here he is giving the name Mirage Water. Now the mirage water actually is cognized in a desert, correct? Desert or wherever there is a lot of heat and light. The water itself is actually an optical illusion brought about by the sun's rays only. The sun's rays themselves create an illusion as though some water is there, but sun's rays are actually Prakasha Swarupa, correct? They are bright, but that excessive brightness itself creates a certain illusion of water being there. So you cannot say that something which is of Prakasha Swarupa cannot be a locus of some other superimposition or adhyasa. So like this, different analogies he is giving. Finally, one more. What is that? Sthanau choravat akriye. So how can we imagine all this activity? You are saying Atma is nishkriyam. Okay. Naishkarmya siddhim. All is there. Even in Bhagavad Gita also, Bhagavan says, Atma does not do anything. Okay. Nayam hantina hanyate. It does not kill. Neither cause somebody to kill, nor gets killed. Veda vinashinam nityam enamajam avyayam katam sapurusha parthakam ghatayati hantikam. Like this, Atma does not do anything. It is there as it is. Its mere presence is good enough for all these activities to take place. Like this we say. So here, for that also, Sureshvara is giving this analogy that there is a pole. It is actually stationary. But in that stationary pole, you see a thief, okay, chora. On seeing the thief again, what you think that he is standing there with some kind of a weapon, a knife or a sword or whatever, and he is brandishing it at you. All that activity you are imagining. So, even though Atma is Nishkriyam, Kriya can be superimposed on that. So like this, all types of erroneous cognition are possible, even though none of these things are there in Atma. So for that, different analogies Sureshvara has given beautifully. So essentially what finally is summarizing, Asat Kalpamidam Vishvam Atmanyaropyate Brahmat. So finally, what is the conclusion? This Jagat is Asat Kalpam. It is almost non-existent only. But it appears. That's why we cannot say it is totally non-existent. But it is as though something which is not there only is cognized. So something which is really not there. Asat Kalpam Idam Vishvam. This, whatever you are perceiving as this world, this, the entire objective world, doesn't really exist. It is really only the both the subject and object are only a superimposition on oneself. Okay, Atmani Aropyate Brahma. It is only due to Brahma. It's a delusional cognition born out of ignorance, avidya. And you cannot ask when did this Brahma start. It is beginningless. Naisargikaha ayam loka vyavaharaha bhashakara. Okay, it is beginningless. It is there naturally. Okay. Then what? So what is the reality of oneself? Swayam prakasham sadrupam bhranti bhadha vivarjitam pratyabhijnayate vastu Pragvan mohe vyapohite dehadyupadhav nirdute syadatmaiva maheshwaraha. So pratyabhijnayate vastu. Vastu is recognized. Oneself, the reality of oneself is recognized. Pragvat, however it was. Okay, originally, when mohe vyapohite, when this moha, this avidya, ignorance is gone, is removed by knowledge, by vritti jnana. Okay, by the knowledge which takes place in your mind only. And then what is this reality of yourself? Means Swayam Prakasham Sadrupam, self-revealing, self-existent Atma. The Atma which is self-existent, self-revealing. Okay. And in which there is no error. Bhranti Vivarjitam. So in reality, there is not, all this erroneous cognition are not there in the Atma really. Like even the snake is not there really in the rope. The snake was never there. Originally the snake was not there in the rope. Even while you are seeing the snake also, snake is not there, really speaking. And after it, the snake has been negated also, only rope is there. So in all three periods of time, the snake was not there really. Snake did not make any change to the rope also. The rope Swarupa is rope Swarupa only always. The nature of the rope has not changed because you perceived snake on that rope. So in reality, the rope does not have any, whatever you see erroneously, that thing is not there in the locus where you are seeing it. So it is Bhranti Vivarjitam, Badha Vivarjitam also. Atma can never be negated. The world can be negated. Okay. The entire objective universe can be negated. But the negator can never be negated. Understand that. You can negate everything. But what about the one who is negating? That negator is you. Okay. That is Atma. The negator Swarupa is Satyam. The nature of the negator is Satyam. That can never be negated. So Bhranti and Badha Vivarjitam, Swayam Prakasham Sadrupam. This is your true nature. And that has to be recognized. And all delusion has to be removed. All other notions about oneself, all that is only delusion. Okay. And that delusion is in the form of taking yourself as your body, mind, sense complex. So, Dehadi Upadhav Nirdhute Syad Atmaiva Maheshwaraha. So, by the knowledge that Aham Brahmasmi, Jagatkaranam Brahma, Aham Asmi, Ishwaroham, Shivoham. So I am nothing but Ishwara. I am Ishwara only. By that knowledge, these delusional wrong notions about oneself, that I am the body, I am the mind, I am the senses, all these wrong notions about oneself are removed. And then you are as you are. Okay. You are as you are. There is nothing else. All other cognition, all other notions about yourself are all only wrong notions. I am is the reality. I am so and so means, that's it. From there, your wrong notion starts about yourself. I am an individual problem. The individual is really Brahman. So you have to negate the individuality. Your own individuality comes and goes. So you have to appreciate that fact, that one's own individuality itself is not something which is always there. The individuality can even change in dream. In waking, you think you are a human being, you are a man, you are a woman and all that. In your dream world, I don't know what body you are taking, what kind of yavahara you are doing. So the individuality comes and goes, and the individuality in fact resolves in deep sleep. Even though you are there, you are not there as an individual in the deep sleep. So the very individuality comes and goes. It is not real. It has no reality. The individual is real, but the individuality of the individual is only an appearance. You are Atma, Swayam Prakasha, Swatasiddha Atma. That's what has to be appreciated. Okay, all this jnanam, how do we gain? Okay. Means here, you can see here, smritif pratyaksham aitihyam ityadinya paranyapi. pramananyaptavagaha pratyabhijna prasiddhaye. So how do I get this knowledge, this pratyabhijna? How do I recognize myself? Okay. So for this recognition to be obtained, okay, for getting this recognition, for being established in this knowledge only, okay, the aptavak aha, Veda has said, okay, what did the Veda say? So here Sureshvara is actually quoting a Taittiriya Aranyaka Vakya. Okay, so in Taittiriya Aranyaka there is a Vakya, Smritif Pratyaksham Aitihyam Anumanas Chatushtayam Etai Raditya Mandalam Sarvaireva Vidhasyate, like that. Of course, I am chanting it in a different swara. If you know the Krishna Yajurveda, then the Veda swara is different, but it is also in Anushtup Chandas. So the Taittiriya Aranyaka talks about Aditya Mandala. In fact, that the Aditya who is obtaining in the Aditya Mandala is the one who is also obtaining in your eyes, the Akshini Purushaha. Like that you can do an Upasana. So the Aditya is nothing but Brahman, Pratyaksha Brahma. And how do we know that this Aditya is the one who is the one in the in your eyes also? Even Gayatri Japa is the same thing. The Gayatri Mantra also essentially says the same. Okay. And so these things are all established by Smriti, Pratyaksha, Aitihya, and other Pramanas also. Like that, Sureshvara is saying Anumana, etc. So Smriti, Bhagavad Gita is saying what? Kshetrajnam chapi mam vidhi sarva kshetreshu bharat. So Bhagavan is saying, I am the Kshetrajnaha. The Kshetra, all the different bodies are all Kshetra. And the one who knows the Kshetra in each and every Kshetra, the Kshetrajnaha, is not separate from me. So this Vakya is there in Bhagavad Gita. There are so many more are also there. Okay, we can say Aham Atma Guda Kesha Sarva Bhuta Shayastitaha Aham Adischa Madhyancha Bhutana Manta Yevacha. Like this, different Bhagavad Gita verses are there. Other smritis also we can quote, but typically smriti means Bhagavad Gita is taken. Then pratyaksha means one's own anubhava, the anubhava of the different jnani. So that is the pratyaksha, swanubhava. Once one knows clearly, that knowledge is direct knowledge. There is nothing indirect about oneself, correct? You are always experiencing yourself directly. And once all the wrong notions about you goes away, then whatever is there, correct? That is again the direct anubhava continues. The direct experience, aparoksha anubhuti. It is not paroksha, it is not indirect, it is direct. There is nothing to cloud anymore. All the delusions, wrong notions about oneself is gone, and you are as you are. Then Aitihyam means the traditional knowledge, you can say. passed down from Guru to Shishya. So the Pratyaksha can be taken as Aham Brahmasmi in the form of Aham Brahmasmi. The Aitihyam can be taken as in the form of Tattvamasi. Tattvamasi is the Upadesha Vakya, correct? It is the Veda Vakya, but Guru Mukhena, traditionally it is taught by the Guru. You are that Jagat Karanam Brahma, Tattvamasi. So Tattvamasi is the traditional knowledge, traditional teaching. And there is a methodology to teach that also. That is called the Sampradaya. Pratyaksha means one's own, the Tattvamasi, once you have understood it clearly, becomes Aham Brahmasmi. That is your Swanubhava, your direct Anubhava experience, direct knowledge. Okay. Then different Anumana also are useful. Shruti, Sammata, Tarka, you can say. So all these things help you in gaining this recognition of yourself. Pratyabhijna prasiddhaye. For the Pratyabhijna to be established properly, for it to be obtained, all these pramanas are there. Like this, the Taittiriya Aranyaka itself says that. Aptavag aha. So with this, this chapter is over. Iti Shri Dakshinamurthy Stotrartha Pratipadake Prabandhe Manasollase Saptamollasa Sangraha. So the Saptamollasa is over. The seventh shloka has been explained. So now Sureshvara is going to give some introduction to the 8th shloka. We'll just chant the 8th shloka now. Vishvam pashyati karya karanataya swaswami sambandhataha shishyacharyataya tathaiva pitruputradhyatmana bhedataha swapne jagrati vaya esha purusho maya paribhramitaha Tasmai Shri Guru Murtaye Nama Idam Shri Dakshina Murtaye. We'll see the meaning of this verse, but before that we'll just see some of the introductory verses given by Sureshvara. So how is he introducing this? Typically in the form of a question from a Sishya. So all these verses, he is presenting it as the answers given by a guru for specific questions of the Sishya. So here, what is the question again further? So Sishya is asking, Prakasha Vyatirekena Padarthah Kopi Nasti Chet Paramarthopadeshantaha Vyavaharah Katham Bhavet. So Sishya is again asking, because previously all this Pratyabhijna we were talking about, and we said that Atma alone is there, okay, which is Swayam Prakasha Swarupaha, Swatasiddha Swarupaha. So Sishya is asking, if nothing other than Prakasha is there, the Swayam Prakasha Atma is there, okay, Prakasha Vyatirekena Padartha Kopi Nasti Chet, there is no other thing really existing other than this Uprakasha Atma, this Prakasha Vastu. If that is the case, how can there be any Vyavahara? Because after you have given this knowledge, you have been taught Paramartham, okay, Paramartha Upadeshantaha Vyavaharaha Katham Bhavet. So at the end of this Paramartha Upadesha, having been instructed by the Guru, or even Guru himself, how can he be there? How can there be any Vyavahara, Guru Sishya Vyavahara? or any other vyavahara for that, any other transaction, how can it be there only because Atma alone is there? If Atma alone is there, how can there be a teaching? How can there be a teacher? How can there be a taught? Isn't it illogical? Obviously, it is illogical. How is it possible? That is the question of the Shishya. Further, he is asking, Kasya bandhascha mokshascha badhyate kena hetuna. So this bandha, who is bound? Okay. This samsara is for whom? All this bondage is for whom? Kasya bandha, whose is this bondage? And who gets freedom also? Mokshascha kasya, for whom is this freedom from bondage? So who is bound, who is freed? And badhyate kena hetuna, by what is one bound? Because of what cause? Okay, what is the cause of this bondage? And what is the lakshana of maya? Okay, you may say that everything is maya, but what is this maya? What are the characteristics of this maya? How can you define it? Mayayaha lakshanam kim? So mayayaha lakshanam kim syat ityevam paripritchataha. So like this, these questions are all there. Okay. The Shishya has these questions, that how can this Prakasha Swarupa Atma, if that is the only reality, nothing else exists, how can all this Vyavahara be there? Even the Guru Shishya Vyavahara itself, how is it possible? Mainly. And who has bondage? For whom is this freedom? And due to what cause one is bound? And what is the nature of this Maya? What, how do you characterize it? All these questions having been asked, the Guru has to answer. So prashnasyaduttaram vaktum pratipattum sukhe nacha uktarthas saptabhis shlokaihi punas samkshipya kathyate. So to answer these questions, okay, so uttaram vaktum and also sukhena pratipattum cha, also to help the Shishya understand easily, uktartaha, already whatever has been said, okay, in the previous 7 shlokas, many things have been explained, okay, by Shankara Bhagavadpada. Acharya has explained beautifully the entire Vedanta in 7 shlokas. But the same thing he is now repeating. Okay, punaha kathyate sankshipya, summarizing the entire teaching, Acharya is again repeating. The Guru is summarizing so that Shishya can easily understand. Sukhena pratipattum, and also to answer the all these questions which may arise in the minds of the Shishya. Whatever has been already said in the 7 shlokas, saptabhihi shlokaihi uktartaha, punaha sankshipya kathyate, again it is being said in a summary fashion, in a concise manner. Okay. Okay, now somebody may say, No, punarikti is a dosha. What is the point in telling the same thing again? Pishtasya peshanam, they say. You are grinding the same flour again and again. Already it is ground. Aracha maviya arakira. Like this we say in Tamil. You are grinding the flour which has been already ground. What is the use? Hishtasya peshanam. Means Sureshwara is answering that also. He is saying, Paunaruktyam na doshotra shabdenarthena va bhavet abhyasena gariyastvam arthasya pratipadyate. So paunaruktyam, see, when you are teaching that to a subtle subject matter like Atma, repetition is not a defect or a dosha. You have to present the same thing. See, Vedanta can be presented in half a shloka, correct? But it can be also taught over an entire lifetime. That means we are going to only repeat many times, maybe from using different analogies, from different standpoints. The teaching is the same. So all this repetition is not a defect. In fact, it is required. One has to repeatedly listen to the Guru. Paunah punyam shravanam kurya. Like this, there is a saying also. There is a mandate. You have to listen to the Shastra from the Guru again and again and again. And there is no defect in this. So whether in the form of the words or also the meaning also, you have to repeat in your mind. Shabdena arthena. So you have to also recollect whatever you have listened to. Because an insight has to be repeated for it to become clear knowledge, unhindered knowledge. You may get insights when you are attending the class, when you are listening to your guru. But then insights may not be powerful enough because one's own tendencies, the habitual tendencies which are already there, are really very powerful. These tendencies are coming over multiple lifetimes, in fact. So it won't go away by just an insight. Even a powerful insight is not enough. For you to transform yourself and attain a new self-identity, this repetition has to be there until your new identity is natural, sahaja. That's what is called sahaja samadhi. It has to be natural. How naturally you are thinking that you are an individual, that has to go away. Aham Brahmasmi has to be natural. That has to be your identity. Till that identity is natural, repetition has to be there. There is no dosha in that. Paunaruktyam is not a dosha. Paunaruktyam na doshaha. Because by abhyasa only, by repeated, by repetition, repeated practice, this whatever, this knowledge, this understanding happens. Whatever is revealed to you, that knowledge can be established in you with clarity, without any doubts, without any habitual tendencies obstructing you from enjoying the results of this knowledge. So this abhyasa is very important. Abhyasena tu kaunteya vairagyena cha grihyate, like this Bhagavan says. but in the context of mind also. So the mind is very difficult to master. It is running here and there. Mind is the one which is showing us this duality. In one way, it is the locus of all your ignorance also. So knowledge also has to take place in that mind only, and to prepare that mind, one has to repeatedly make effort. Okay, this abhyasa is very, very important. Therefore, repetition is never a defect. In Vedanta, in fact, it's all only repetition. Whichever text you may study, understand that, because some people have a certain tendency that they want to study different verses, different texts. They even feel good. I have covered all the Upanishads. I have covered 18 chapters of Bhagavad Gita. I have studied the entire Brahma Sutra. And then I have studied different Prakarana Grantha, Panchadashi. But the subject matter is the same. What you are supposed to understand from all these things are the same. To keep yourself entertained, you may look at different texts. Okay, but essentially, the subject matter is the same. What you are supposed to understand, whatever knowledge you are supposed to gain, is one and the same. So each and every class you attend, it's only revealing your own nature to yourself. That subject matter is very simple, but still it requires a certain effort on your part till it becomes effortless. Your self-identity has to be established and be available effortlessly. The transformation has to take place. Till then, all this abhyasa, this repetition is required. Okay, so now, having seen this introduction, we'll quickly see the meaning of the verse itself. Vishvam pasyati karya karanataya swaswami sambandhataha shishyacharya taya tathaiva pitruputra adhyatmana bhedataha. Swapne jagrati vaya yesha purushaha maya paribhramitaha. So maya paribhramitaha purushaha yesha purushaha. This person, this individual, purushaha, purishayanat purushaha, the one who is purausheti iti, one who is obtaining in this fort which has 9 doors, correct? Navadvare pure dehi, even in Gita. Okay, navadvare pure, the one, this puri, which has 9 doors, in this Atma is sitting. This individual who is deluded by avidya, maya, maya paribhramitaha, one who is deluded by this maya. Being deluded, what does this person see? Even though there is only one reality, that one reality is being seen as many. So this, he is seeing this entire world, Vishvam Pashyati. So this deluded person is seeing this entire world. How? In what way? Karya Karanataya, as cause and effect. different causes, different effects. Okay, so you are separating cause and effects, and different causes are also there. Then in what other form? Swaswami sambandhatah. Okay, as property and owner, or servant and master and all that, you can say swaswami. So one's own, something which is one's own, and the owner, the owner and the owned. Swaswami means, okay, cause and effect, owner and owned. Then also teacher and student, Sishyacharyataya. And similarly, tathaiva what? Pitru putradi atmana bhedatah. Also as son and father, all these differences in oneself. Okay. Oneself, I am seeing, see, I am the father of my son, but I am the son of my father. I am the teacher to my students, and I am a student to my guru. I am whatever, I am a boss to somebody, and to my boss, I am a subordinate. Like this, in the world, if you see, one thing itself is seen differently. There is only one person. That person can be looked upon as a son or a father. The same person can be looked upon as a student or a teacher. Same person can be looked upon as an owner or an owned, or a cause or an effect. The same thing can be looked upon as a cause or an effect. So like this, the world, in the world itself, one thing can be looked upon in different ways, but the world itself is being looked upon in all these different ways also. Is it clear? So all these bheda, all these divisions, one is perceiving. And when one is perceiving all these differences, both in dream, swapne, jagrati, and in waking also. Okay, the individual in his dream or her dream, and the individual in the waking world is perceiving all these differences. And that individual, why that individual is perceiving all these differences? Because of Maya. These differences are not real. They are all only appearances. These differences do not really divide oneself. It's only a perception. So it's all only some kind of delusion, delusory perception due to one's own ignorance. And who is that person? So Puri Shayanath, if you see, that person is individual, but in reality that individual's nature is not different from Dakshinamurthy. So if you look upon Purushaha, can be also looked upon as Purnatva Purushaha, the one who is complete in oneself, one who does not lack anything, one who is not a wanting person, complete whole in oneself, Purnatva Purushaha. So the one, this Ishvara alone, due to ignorance, has become this Jiva, this individual. And then the Ishvara is available as the individual also. that Ishwara Swarupa is still available to be recognized by the individual. That is what we call Pravesha. The Pravesha Shruti we are seeing now in Taittiriya, in Brihadaranyaka and all that, means the availability, available for recognition. Ishwara is available for you to recognize as yourself. That availability is what is called as that Ishwara has entered you as though entered your Sukshma Sharira, entered your mind, and is available for recognition as yourself. So that Ishwara, who himself is deluded as the individual, who is appearing as the deluded individual, to that Dakshinamurthy, who is the Guru Murthy also, who is in the form of the Adi Guru, my namaskaras. So how does this answer means, this Shishya is asking, how can this Prakasha itself appear? How can there be any Vyavahara? Means all Vyavahara is really Maya only. It has no reality. It's only an appearance. It's all only Maya. It's all a spinning of the Maya only. Okay. Nowadays we say media is spinning different stories and all that, correct? They spin their own something. You can't believe what is coming in the news anymore. Everybody is spinning their own agenda, their own story. Like that, this entire world is nothing but a spin only. It's all Maya. If you try to analyze it, it will vanish. Okay. Vicharam na sahate, we say. What is Maya means? Maya is something which cannot tolerate analysis. Once you start analyzing it, it is like peeling onion only. You peel the entire onion and you don't see anything finally, correct? You can keep on going deeper and deeper. You can go for the fundamental particles, quarks, whatever, fundamental building blocks. Finally, it will all resolve into yourself only, the observer. So if you start analyzing, it's not there. Even physically, if we start analyzing, physicists are saying it's all, more than 99% is only space. Then how are we doing all this vyavahara, that this is solid, this is liquid, this is gas, this is plasma, whatever, correct? Because at an atomic level, the nucleus and the electrons are only occupying less than 1%. Rest are all only space. So how is this possible? Means that is the Maya. Correct? How is all these few fundamental particles appearing as all this variegated world? Means that is Maya, in fact. Nobody can answer that. That's only an appearance. The same thing appears differently at a micro level. And at a macro level, it appears differently. All that is Maya, in fact. So this Maya only makes all these appearances possible. Okay, Maya is making all this appearance possible. But what about this Guru Shishya Vyavahara? I am more interested in that. Okay. How is this knowledge which is being taught, is it real or not? Okay. This is a big question. In fact, Dvaitins and Vishishtadvaitins and all, they always raise this point. If you say that everything is maya, mithya, what about the status of the mithya itself? And what about the teaching? Is the teaching real or false? If you say, okay, they try to put you in a spot now, correct? They say, if you say the teaching is false, then you cannot have any proper knowledge. But if the teaching and the teacher and the taught are real, because if you say the teaching is real, then it will imply the teacher, taught, all these things also have to be real. Means then Dvaita will come. How are you going to answer this? You are stuck. Correct? So that's where we say, only if the problem is real, the solution has to be real. The problem itself is not real. Understand that. Ignorance is not real. Ignorance also is mithya. For removing mithya ignorance, mithya knowledge is good enough. For waking you up from your dream, dream tiger is good enough, correct? A dream tiger which frightens you can wake you up. Also, in fact, Sureshvara gives other examples and all later in the Vartika, we'll see that. So, to produce a real effect, the cause itself need not be of the same order of reality. That also he will point out. We'll see all that in the next class. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.
Dhanyavadam.